Good afternoon, and thank you for tuning in today. On behalf of the University of California San Francisco Alumni Association, the UCSF Department of Psychiatry, the Greater Good Science Center at UC Berkeley, and the MindSight Institute, welcome to the second webcast of our series titled Emotional Well-being During the COVID-19 Crisis for Healthcare Providers. This week's topic is Psychological First Aid Strategies for Frontline Workers. I will now turn it over to our host, Dr. Lissa Epple.
Okay, hello everyone, welcome. We are so happy to be together again during this critical period. Today we have a very special hour. We have a special guest first that we're going to hear from before we get to hear Lisa Fortuna and Bruce Perry. So we've asked Robert Rodriguez to join us for a few minutes at the beginning. Robert is a professor of emergency medicine, associate chair of research in the Department of Emergency Medicine, and attending in the emergency department at the Zuckerberg San Francisco General Hospital. You grew up in the border town of Brownsville, Texas. Robert is also a researcher. We pulled him out of the hospital to spend a few minutes with us and tell us about his research project that somehow, on top of being an attending right now in the ER, he has really wanted to document the sources of stress for providers and really understand their psychological experience right now. So he's going to give us a little preview of what he's finding. And before that, because it's important to also have a time of kind of humor and expression of this complex range of emotions that we're all experiencing, especially our frontline providers, I'm going to show you very briefly a few cartoons shared from some Indu Subramanian, a surgeon at UCLA, and Michael Moskowitz, a psychologist at UCLA. Okay, so I'll just let you absorb this. Sorry, let me start in the beginning. Okay, the emotional world of healthcare providers on the front lines of COVID. Shock. Betrayal. Envy. Frustration, fear, foreboding, exhaustion, grief. Terror. Solidarity. Courage. And hope. A lot to experience in a very short period. The fear and anxiety is of course the most threatening and powerful of these emotions. That's partly what we'll be focusing on today. So Robert, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us for a bit.
Thanks for including me.
So we'd love to hear from you what you're seeing, finding, feeling from the front lines.
Yeah, so I work in the emergency department at San Francisco General, and early on have noted intense anxiety, a lot of stress arising from the COVID pandemic. And so we decided to take a systematic look at this and are conducting a longitudinal assessment of the levels of anxiety and the sources of this anxiety, as well as looking at what providers think might help decrease their anxiety. And we're conducting this study at six sites. Four of them are in California, there's our site in San Francisco, UCSF, there's UCLA affiliated campuses, there's UCSF Fresno, and there's UC San Diego. And then we also have two other sites. One is in Camden, New Jersey, Rowan Cooper University Medical School. And then New Orleans, LSU, the medical school, emergency medicine program there. And so we've taken a preliminary look at our findings, and we found that, not surprisingly, there's a lot of anxiety, both in the workplace and being transmitted to home life as well. So on a scale of 1 to 7, where providers would say 1 equals not at all, no exact anxiety at all, to 7 is extreme anxiety, our median levels are around 5.3, and it's pretty clustered around that point, around that number, such that this represents a moderate to severe level of anxiety across the board. And we, again, are looking at how this translates into stress at home. And we're finding that providers' home life has been impacted significantly. They are having to change their whole way of life at home. They're having to change their behavior in terms of showing signs of affection. They are, there's a lot of concern, a lot of stress regarding exposing their family members to, because of their work as healthcare workers on the front line, and a lot of concerns about quarantine, having to go under quarantine, and the effects that would have on their families. So overall, we're documenting or we're finding a lot of stress, not surprisingly, again, a lot of stress, both at home and in the workplace.
Well, it's very, very moving. You guys are the heroes of this moment in history. And, you know, we just want to do everything we can to help. If there is anything, particular things that all of you listening to on the front lines feel would be most helpful that's not happening, besides getting enough PPE, et cetera, you know, we are also collating suggestions and tips of how you are all coping. We are going to have that on the Department of Psychiatry website today from last week, and there were some beautiful ways of being things that you are saying to yourselves that are helping you get through these difficult moments each day that will be really helpful for all of your colleagues to see. So continue sharing. And Robert, I just am so grateful for your work and your research. And we're all learning from this. We're all in this for the long run. And we want to help you guys get through the immediate crisis. That's why we're focusing on what can you do now in the moment during your day. And for all of us, just thinking of the long run of how we can prevent burnout and really help, you know, protect the mental health during this crisis as well. If there's any wish you have or question you have, Robert, for the speakers, you should feel free to say what your own question is.
Well, first of all, we want to make it clear that this is a team effort. Everybody in the emergency department is extremely grateful for your efforts in terms of supporting our mental health. So the kudos go out to you as well, you and your team. I think that one thing that could be helpful would be sort of a real-time measure or something that we could do in real time in, like, say, a minute or two in the emergency department to kind of relieve stress a measure like that would be very helpful. And again, we, you know, this dealing with this pandemic is completely a team deal. You all are on the front line as well, and we appreciate your help.
Thank you so much, Robert. I think your wish will be fulfilled today. We have two experts in trauma-informed care, and they're really going to focus on acute strategies, how to protect children as well, and the relationships at home are just so important, and that's just another piece of the added challenge for frontline providers, and we'll be addressing that further in our webinars. Thank you, Robert. Have a wonderful day. I'm glad you can, and hope you can listen to the rest of this.
I will be listening. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it.
So I'd like to next introduce Dr. Lisa Fortuna, who's a vice chair of psychiatry, chief of psychiatry at the UCSF Zuckerberg General Hospital. She's also an ordained minister, and she's originally from Puerto Rico. She spent time on the East Coast, and we're very blessed to have her in the Bay Area now. And secondly, I want to welcome Bruce Perry, a psychiatrist who has been how to protect our children. Just beautiful work and books that have reached so many people. Bruce is a senior fellow in the Child Trauma Academy and an author. Thank you both.
Thank you. Thank you, Alyssa and everyone. So I'm just going to start very briefly in continuing to set the stage, which I think has been initiated beautifully. So I'm just going to share something very quickly from my screen. And I'm hoping everyone can see that. Okay, so as was mentioned, I'm the chief of psychiatry, and this has been a sort of frontline experience for our department as well, which I imagine is happening across the country in with our psychiatry colleagues, as well as our medical and surgical colleagues. Some of the themes that I have been experiencing as someone who's in leadership and trying to work through this crisis that we have is, you know, if we really look at a disaster model, right, which I think has been put up in different instances, you know, we definitely had a pre-disaster context where we were preparing, right, for the potential for COVID-19 to come and not really knowing how it was going to completely hit, but knowing that we had to do this social distancing, we had to prepare our services to be able to serve our psychiatric patients as well as support our colleagues. We've had the impact. And some of the things that I have definitely seen is this phase of heroic action. You know, people are really stepping up to the plate in terms of supporting one another on the front lines and in services, as well as trying to provide support for our medical colleagues in the emergency room, you know, making sure that we all can stay strong and continuing to work. The community has been extremely sort of supportive in bringing us food and sort of identifying folks as heroes. And there is this sort of increase in community cohesion, I think, in some of the things that we've been hearing this morning even. But in the same token, when we look at this performance stress level curve, lots of curves in this situation, we're definitely in the motivated and focused stage, but we are, I think, at risk of falling into the fatigued and stress overload part of this curve up here, and into not being well. Part of it is that what I'm even finding in my staff is that people wanna continue to perform to meet the needs. Very difficult to get people to take breaks and rest, and very difficult also when they do have those additional concerns at home, where they also have to be on it in terms of supporting family and friends and children. So we're really trying to work on how to provide support so that the peak performance doesn't fall into the sick or overloaded stress realm of things. And it's going to be a long haul, right? As we see in that disaster, there's going to be ongoing ups and downs in this situation. So we've been trying to use psychological first aid principles of looking for basic needs, making sure that people have, you know, housing and food, and that our patients also have those things. Listening, trying to comfort, connecting, really sort of encouraging those ongoing connections despite the social physical distancing. Protecting, how do we get those PPE sufficiently in those places that it needs to be? How do we sort of allow for some social distancing for providers that are in psych emergency services? How do we do that for our patients? So really trying to really do that, and then instilling hope that we'll do this together. So this has been, you know, some of the things that we've had to really try to do together. So I just wanted to set that up. Let me make sure I can get out. Okay, so I've stopped sharing. And so I want to bring Bruce now into this conversation, because I think we're really hungry to hear any wisdom that you might have of how does neurobiology of acute stress inform us and potentially help us in figuring out how to do this, like sort of what Robert was saying, real-time management, right, of what we're experiencing in this long haul.
Sure. So first of all, thank you for asking me to be part of this. I think some of you may know, but if you don't, I'm part of a very big group that has been working on understanding stress and distress and trauma for 30 plus years. And there's a couple of things that I'm going to actually show a few slides and talk a little bit about the underlying biology of this, because I want the people who hear some of these really specific recommendations to understand why we would make this recommendation and why, even though it seems pretty silly, it's actually tremendously powerful physiologically, and if you actually do some of these things, you'll find yourself a little bit better regulated. So I'm gonna steal the screen here for a minute and show you some slides. And first of all, I just want to start out by sort of acknowledging the fact that all of you in the healthcare industry, you know, all of you who are listening, are actually pretty familiar with stress. I mean, this, you know, the work that we do, the training that we've done, all of it has basically had aspects of stress permeated through it. So I think most of us are pretty comfortable with the concept of stress. We function under stress. In fact, what we know is that you can't really learn anything new without stressing. And so stress is really in and of itself not a bad thing. But we do know that the pattern of stress is really, really important. And so if you experience stress in an unpredictable, prolonged, or extreme way, you alter your stress response capabilities and make yourself more vulnerable. In contrast, if you can bring some controllability or predictability to the stressful circumstances in your life, you can build resilience. And I think this is kind of what many people in medicine have learned to do, that they've learned how to bring some predictability, controllability to things that to other people would be overwhelmingly stressful. But you're currently in a situation where you're under prolonged stress. And I think that as Lisa showed, one of the consequences of that is exhaustion, both mental and physical. And this, of course, is completely predictable. If you know, I'm gonna show you a heuristic. This is kind of a cartoon of the brain. And the brain, we sort of teach by showing people this upside down triangle and the top part being the cortex and the bottom part being the brainstem. And what we know is the brain is organized in a hierarchical way, and that we have these very fundamental core regulatory networks that originate in low parts of the brain, and they send direct connections to every other part of the brain, and they send connections both directly and indirectly out to the rest of the body. So these core regulatory networks are kind of the backbone of how we manage stress. And as we get incoming information, we get incoming information from the, we get incoming information from the outside world, and we get feedback from the inside world. And the first place all of that stuff goes is down to these lower parts of the brain. And it communicates to these core regulatory networks so they can turn on and turn off systems as appropriate for the circumstance. And the reason this is important is that one of the things that happens is when you are under significant stress and distress, your brain basically will make decisions for you. It will turn off certain systems in the cortex, and it will activate other systems in your body to help you get through the current threat, whatever it is. And so we talk a lot about state-dependent functioning. And basically what state-dependent functioning means is that when you are calm, you have access to certain systems in your body and brain. And when you are under threat, you will have access to other systems and shut down key systems. And again, very simplistically, when you're calm and regulated, you have a lot of access to these cortical systems that have to do with reasoning and thinking about the future and being hopeful and reflecting on the past. But when you start to get threatened, you shut down the cortex. And anybody who works, for example, in ER medicine sees people come in panic, in threat. They're anxious, they're overwhelmed. And one of the big things that you do is take advantage of the neurobiology of relational contagion. You're a calm ER physician, you're a calm nurse, you see a parent come in who's panicked because their child's got a cut on their head and they're bleeding, and you stay calm and you regulate them. And little by little, what happens is, because of the relational contagion, you calm that person down. And so one of the most important things that's at play currently in all of our healthcare situations is this relational contagion, emotional contagion. If the leader of the team is regulated, it will help regulate the other people in the group. And I'll come back in a minute and talk about really concrete things that your leaders in your healthcare settings can do to help regulate the staff. And now the other reason I showed this is that just because of the rules of neuroplasticity, and I don't want to go into it in much detail, but neuroplasticity basically is a term we use to capture and describe the malleability, the changeability of systems in the brain. And this is true for these core regulatory networks. They're changeable. Their activity is changeable. We can do things if we directly activate them that can calm them down, and we can do things if we activate them in different ways to make them escalate. And so one of the most powerful tools that all of you have, that we all have, to self-regulate is to take advantage of a deeply ingrained set of associations that were created earlier in life that we made in utero, basically between patterned repetitive somatosensory activity and being regulated. And without going into this in too much detail, basically when you're in utero, you're getting feedback from your body that says, I'm not hungry, I'm not thirsty, I'm not cold, I'm regulated. And you're getting input from the outside world that is this, this nonstop rhythmic input that comes in through three different senses: vibratory, tactile, and auditory. And so your brain, as if in utero, makes an association between pattern, repetitive, rhythmic, somatosensory activity and being regulated. And so later on, when you learn how to do bilateral tapping, or you get up and pace, or you do, you go running or ride a bike or take deep breaths, if you do something that's somatosensory, that is in one of the rhythm, primary rhythms, or a submultiple of your primary regulatory rhythm, which is between 60 and 80 beats per minute, you're going to feel regulated. And this is why people chew gum and they wiggle their leg, and when they get nervous, they, you know, you see kids that will rock themselves, and you look at all these frequencies, they're all about the same. And so two of these things, the reason I'm talking about these two, sort of the relational regulation and somatosensory regulation, is that when we talk about what to do when you're working, what to do if you are in a high pressure situation, like a well-regulated person working in the ER, you've got one challenge, and then you've got another challenge, and then you've got another challenge. And if you're well-regulated, pretty soon you get dysregulated, you start to get worn out. And so fortunately, you'll have a little bit of a break, maybe lunch. And then by the end of the day, you'll be sort of at wit's end, and then you go home. And before this event, you could go home and get regulated by touching and interacting with your partner, your kids, your neighborhood. You could see friends, you could do all kinds of regulatory things. You could go work out, you could talk with people, you could do that, and then come back the next day ready to work again. But part of what I'm going to suggest is that you're going to have to be very intentional during the workday about taking little regulatory breaks in between your doses of challenge. And that's going to keep you in a more engaged, regulated state. And because if you're not getting a chance to recharge every day when you go home, and this is day after day after day after day, long shift after long shift after long shift, and you're working like this, you're going to start coming in, and pretty soon you're going to be sensitized, and you're going to be dysregulated, and you're going to be less functional and efficient as the day goes on. And I would bet that there are people out there who've seen this in their staff, that people are maybe not as able to do things as quickly or as efficiently as they may have before. And if this goes on for months, we will end up having a significant shift in the fundamental regulatory capabilities of somebody. And you know, you may have a whole resilient, well-regulated staff, and if they keep getting worn out, and they're going to end up being more neurotypically regulated. And if they keep getting even more worn out, they're going to end up over here and become sensitized. And you know, there's some concrete things that you can do to keep yourself over here. You know, you can bring structure and predictability to your day and to your family. And there's also some predictable things. If this is what happens, and you get sleep disruption, and you don't have enough exercise, and you get all of these dysregulating things, you're going to shift your capacity to demonstrate resilience. And so most of you probably started out somewhere in here. And the longer this goes on, and this is kind of just exactly what Lisa said, the longer this goes on, the more we're going to become no longer be superheroes. We're going to be just like everybody else. And then pretty soon we may even start to unravel, and you're going to have staff and people you work with who are completely overwhelmed. And this is, of course, a big challenge. And I know I talked too much, I'm sorry, but let me turn it back over to Lisa and stop sharing there.
I mean, I you know, as someone who is in a leadership role trying to frame a context where people can actually practice these things, one of the challenges that I'm having is that, you know, people may feel, well, you know, right now I feel really energized. I'm pumped in terms of, you know, having my colleagues and we're doing the work. And so I'm okay. You know, I'm not at a risk of burnout because I'm actually really energetic and pumped about what is happening here. And I can't withdraw from that group energy because that wouldn't be fair to my colleagues. And also we're okay if we're in it.
Right.
Is there a way that we can think about from this neurobiological framework of even protective preemptive things that we can do even, you know, and that we may need to do even before we're aware of the stress acuity level for us, just in terms
of the things that happens when you have that energized, I'm on this team, we're gonna is you're burning calories. I mean, you're literally are burning energy, mental energy and physical energy, and you can't sustain it. You know, this isn't a sprint, this is a marathon. And so part of what really the leaders need to do with their staff is help them develop, as you're pointing out, Lisa, these proactive regulatory strategies. Because if you do this stuff before you need them, before you get dysregulated, you're going to be able to go further. I mean, everybody's, I don't care how resilient you are, everybody's going to have their cup drained by the end of this. And the more you sort of protect yourself up front, the longer people are going to be able to be efficient and effective. Now, the good news about all this dosing stuff, you know, I show these little regulatory breaks and stuff. It really only takes 90 seconds. Mm-hmm. And these are the things that I've recommended to places that are high pressure, high volume workplaces, is that after every little sort of bit of work, you know, whatever, however you measure it, whether it's every call with an upset customer, whether it's every ER visit, every time you go in and see a patient and you talk with them about their diagnosis and then you give orders to the nurse, whatever sort of dose you want, what you want to do is make sure that you take 90 seconds and walk for 60 seconds and then do 30 seconds of sort of focused breathing, and you know, take four breaths, five breaths in deep, hold it, let it out. And I know this sounds really overly simplistic, but these regulatory networks in the brain are very used to responding to very short doses of input. In fact, you know, you don't really need to do much more than 90 seconds, 2 minutes to kind of get back to closer to your own baseline. And so we're not asking people to do really long things. You don't have to go for a 15-minute walk after every patient. You just need 90 seconds. And if you build in a little bit of this regulatory strategy, I think that will be very helpful. The other thing that's very important, and this is what we know, and you alluded to this, is that we know that the most powerful buffer against current stress is being connected. Feeling like you belong in a meaningful way to a group of people. And so that's very regulating. However, that group is highly susceptible to contagion. Mm-hmm. So if that group gets somebody who gets overwhelmed, exhausted, angry, frustrated, that literally spreads within the group. And so this is where leadership comes in. The leader, and again, here's the problem with medicine. In medicine, you know, we're not very good at proactive regulatory strategies to sort of reach out and check in on people. We're used to people melting down and then going, oh, we better go talk to them. Mm-hmm. We need to have our leaders intentionally go touch base and have a schedule. I'm going to touch base with everybody on my team, and I'm going to do a 2-minute check-in. And that's part of my job. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to check in on them after I've done my regulatory 90 seconds, mm-hmm. you know, and then I'm going to be present. I'm going to be fully present. I'm going to hear what they have to say. I'm going to be reassuring to the degree that I can, and then I'm going to move on. But you'll be amazed at how powerful that is when these check-ins, they're very regulating and they're very powerful. And what they do is they can counterbalance any relational contagion that has to do with panic and fear and anxiety, as long as the leader is regulated. And this again is a really important thing, is that we have to do what we can to support people in leadership positions to stay as regulated as they can.
Mm-hmm. No, I agree with you. I'm seeing at our leadership level that there are a lot of people who are equally pumped, right, to sort of be able to respond to things. and maybe need to step back and see how they're also getting potentially worn down. So I completely see that.
Yeah.
You talk about the rhythm piece, which I think is a pretty interesting and powerful component. I mean, I know for myself, I need to run, because there is something rhythmic about that's how I can be meditative. What are some things you think that people can do in those 90 seconds or on their breaks to be able to optimize the use of that concept?
Well, that's kind of why I'm saying walk. You know, walking gives you this feedback. And now if you obviously if somebody gets a chance to take a 10-minute run, 5-minute run, 30-minute run, whatever, that's great. But the reality is if you're working in an ER, you don't have a lot of time between, you're going from situation to situation to situation. But it's, again, the 90 seconds, let me just tell you a story about the best advice I ever got in medicine. Mm-hmm. Many of you in medicine will remember this. When you went from being the resident who was sort of, the junior resident to being the senior resident. Once you became the senior resident, you kind of got the red code, you were the person who was supposed to run the codes. And so you're covering the whole house, the whole hospital at night, and you're the lead, you're the main doctor, you're the lead resident. And so I remember the night that I was given the red pager, that was back in the day when they had, so I was given the red pager, the code pager, and my senior resident said, listen, here's what I want you to do. When this goes off, I want you to sit down and take your pulse and don't get up and go to that code until your pulse is less than 100 beats per minute. And I want you to walk to the code. Because he knew that if I was all anxious and overwhelmed and dysregulated and I ran there and got there, I wouldn't be able to remember how to do everything the right way. And in fact, the first time I got paged, what did I do? I ran to the code. Mm-hmm. And I sat there and I'm like, unfortunately I had a nurse who was, who liked me. She looked at me and kind of whispered in my ear and said, don't you want to get a little bicarb? I'm like, bicarb, And she walked me through the code because I was in a state dependent way. I'd shut down my cortex, but she regulated me. And by the end of the night, after three codes, I was able to sort of walk to the code, run it, feel confident and succeed. And I think we need to remember that we will function better as healthcare professionals when we have full access to our cortex. Mm-hmm. That's where all the smart stuff is. Mm-hmm. So we have to regulate ourselves and we have to give ourselves those 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 90 seconds, whatever it takes to kind of pull ourselves together and get regulated to go back into work. Mm-hmm.
I agree. And you're right. I think overall as providers, we have some practice, right? In trying to figure out how to regulate under these, often sort of acute situations. So we do have that to pull. I'm wondering if you have additional advice when it gets a little bit complicated with trauma, where people may already have some existing, even as providers, right? The trauma experiences, I'm noting that some of our folks who are on the front line are finding people in bad situations that could potentially be traumatic and they're showing up with great compassion and empathy, but can be triggered either vicariously or from their own triggering of their own past experiences. And then there's grief involved because we have people who are having people who have passed away because of COVID-19 or in the interim of this all happening. Do we need to think about that in a particular way?
Well, I think it's important, first of all, at baseline, as you know, we haven't been good as a field broadly, medicine, at integrating some of the learnings about the impact of trauma on how people function. And the places that have one of the things that they see right away is exactly what you're identifying, is that many of us, many of the healthcare providers have our own stuff. And there are certain situations that will be particularly cueing. Now, if you've got in place mechanisms to kind of do that, have reflective supervision and kind of help people address that, that's great. I think it's always hard to introduce new practices in the midst of a crisis, right? And so part of what we've been trying to do is help places that are becoming aware that this is an issue, sort of begin to acknowledge that when this is over, we're going to have to figure out a good way to address this. Mm-hmm. But what you're going to see in the meantime is a lot of people are going to have unmet needs. A lot of the people that are healthcare professionals and a lot of the people that they're trying to help. And that's going to generate a sense of helplessness for a lot of people. I think one of the hardest things, at least for many of the people that we work with, that work at baseline with families that are already disenfranchised, resource poor, marginalized because of racism or some other issue, that they're recognizing that under these circumstances, they're even more helpless to help. And they're watching them just fall apart, and it's brutal. It's very hard to be an empathic person and see people you know and care for unraveling and feel helpless about it. It's a very hard thing to do, and I think that that's also what must be happening for many people in the healthcare profession, that they see somebody who comes in as a healthy 40-year-old and all of a sudden they just dissolve, you know, they just medically deteriorate. And I do think that this is going to be a lot of the longer term issues that we have to sort of figure out. We're going to have a lot of secondary trauma, a lot of burnout in our healthcare population. But I don't, you know, I wish I knew things that right up front would help that. You know, I really don't. I mean, aside from acknowledging it, you know, and letting people know that, listen, if there are things, if you find yourself particularly upset, we've got people you can talk to. Mm-hmm. And I know that you guys are providing that service for, you know, for people in your hospital, but a lot of hospitals we know of, they just don't have they don't have very many people that do behavioral health.
Yeah. So. Yeah, I mean, I think we are trying to look at this in the stages, right? As sort of the acute needs of being able to regulate, you know, stay connected, supported, being aware of sort of our stress levels, and then offering, you know, other options as time goes on if people do need to move on to other levels of care, which yeah. I think you is know, important for us to articulate to people.
What happens in a lot of our systems right now is that when people who have their own things and they come in and they do this really hard work, because there aren't institutional care models, everything's sort of pawned off to self-care, take care of yourself. You end up with getting high turnover. So child welfare workers, 30% turnover in the first year. Same thing happens with people that do a lot of this really challenging work is because we're not providing that, the opportunities to take care of them and help them. They for their own protection, they just burn out and they leave the system.
Absolutely. I mean, it's interesting. Some of providers that I've spoken to have said, wow, you know, I'm starting to understand a little bit about what my patients, people I work with, experience who are under chronic pressure and stress. You know, I'm getting a little window into that and that's really informative to them. And where it really sort of comes home is when they're thinking about, wow, I'm having to sort of manage this stress level at work. And then I'm coming home and I have children or family who are also very stressed, and I'm trying to be that calm presence that we know adults need to be to help kids stay okay. What can we do to sort of extend that regulating relational piece to home?
Yeah, you know, Robert brought this up, that it's, you know, a lot of the folks that are working in the healthcare industry, and they'll go back into their neighborhood and people will sort of view them as a potential infectious agent. And so rather than having people sort of, you know, they're happy to sort of keep a block away and clap, you know, that only goes so far. And so I really think that a lot of people in the healthcare profession are they're losing their normal social supports, and even sometimes within their own family. I know people that are actually having to live like in their basement in a semi-quarantine status while the family lives in a different room, different places, and because they don't want their kids to get sick. And so they can't hug them the same way that they would before. They can't read them stories in the same way and snuggle at night. So the first thing I would do is in terms of helping people, both the kids and the families in the situation, is continue to use the regulatory methods that we have available. So even though it's not perfect, you know, reading a story while you're 8 feet away is still reading a story. Mm-hmm. You know, don't give up. You know, you can't give a hug, but you can still tell a joke. You can still Zoom an isolated person, and they see your face and they see an expression, and that's better than nothing. And again, it's these little doses of human contact that are helpful. You know, sometimes it's just in the middle of the day. Fine, looking forward to seeing you later when I call you, or whatever. I think we have to do that kind of thing. But I also think that we have to help people continue to see, remember, this is going to end, particularly children. Let them, listen, this is not going to last forever. This is, you know, we're doing things that are helpful to you and to other people, and this is going to get better. And I think the most powerful elements, if you have a sense, an internal sense, that there's going to be a better future, and you can really endure a lot of stuff. And so I think talking a lot about hopeful things, things that we're going to do in the future, you know, there will, you know, we're not always going to have to live like this. We're going to have family vacations. We're going to be able to go play baseball again. We're going to be able to do all these other things. So that I think is a big part of what you can concretely do. But I'm just putting our healthcare professionals in an incredibly challenging situation, both at work and then because of the social distancing and the need to keep their families safe also at home. So it's tough.
And I mean, I agree. I think sort of keeping some of those patterns, you know, in our homes. I mean, I think that's really important, because I mean, some of the things that I'm hearing is, you know, even teenagers, right? I was having a conversation this morning where we were talking about our teenagers, and someone who has a two-year-old said, well, I'll trade you for the two-year-old, you know, for, you know, to see what's better. You know, are there ways that we can sort of intentionally think about patterns and rhythms in a child's life, right? Because they're right now they're completely off cycle of everything that they know.
Well, we've tried to talk, and a lot of people, I mean, the one thing about the web is it's filled with some really good information. I mean, the more you can maintain routines for the family, have family meals to the degree that you can, try to get up at the same time every day, try to have a set of expectations for the child about their chores, any structure you can bring to the day really will be helpful for everybody. And the other thing is that I didn't really talk about it, but one of the most powerful self-regulatory mechanisms that we have is dissociation. And one of the best ways to dissociate is to read. That's a healthy dissociative thing. And actually playing video games is dissociative, and watching films and televisions are dissociative. So if you use screen time in a creative way, you can give little regulatory breaks to people, and you can alternate being physically active and exercising, which is somatosensory regulation. And then you can use a lot of cognitive top-down regulation by giving reassuring these kids multiple times. So if you use sort of the different routes that we have, relational, top-down sort of cognitive reassurance, bottom-up somatosensory, that sort of tuning out through dissociation. If you think about dosing that throughout the day, you can create a sense of structure and regulation for the child that will, you know, get them through this and help you get through it as well.
Mm-hmm. Alyssa, I see you.
This is an amazing conversation. And we have a few minutes left. I wanted to ask a question to both of you. You've offered some, you know, phenomenal tips on these proactive strategies, check-ins that supervisors can do, using our relational contagion for good, for calming others. And now I just want to ask a personal question to each of you, because there are other people like you who are leaders, who are in the position of being the calm person, of helping others, probably majority of people listening. And I just would love to know what's been helpful to you in this time. You are also have the vulnerability of being a human being who has a life and loved ones and is impacted in your home as well. So is there something that you say to yourself? Is there something that you do that's particularly helpful? We all could use more ideas.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you, the one thing that's been really helpful for me is that I've been homeschooling my 7-year-old grandson, and he lives with us. And I have to say, it just sort of being with the child and sort of putting all this stuff aside and being in the moment and actually seeing, you know, with the world through their eyes, through a child's eyes, is actually, for me, has been really regulating. And kind of, it's very centering. It kind of makes you realize, you know, things that, it's so funny because I'm so worried about, like, oh, is he going to be worried about this? And he's like, no. I mean, that's been very helpful for me. Mm-hmm.
I think for me, some of this sort of, you know, breaks and regulatory stuff has been really helpful for me in terms of, I mean, I was mentioning earlier that walking, running has always been something that's been really regulating for me. And so I try to still do exercise with distance, you know, from people outside. And get up and walk, because the Zoom thing that we have going on can have you sitting for hours, and sort of going out and checking in with people that I'm hoping is supportive for them, but also keeps me connected throughout the day, not just on the Zoom, and trying to keep sort of those patterns of things in my life as much as can feasibly be done. And I think also focusing in on the hope with all of our department, right, and sort of lifting up those moments where we can see us doing our best, you know, and also communicating how we have to take care of ourselves and each other in that. I think, you know, my patterns of heartbeat in my life have been sort of maternal influences, just to be honest, that I've had in my life. So I think sort of this taking care of others and knowing that I have to take care of myself and to be able to do that has been the balance that I think so far has helped. Thinking about an enduring long haul, how do I sort of pull from those roots and those patterns in my life that have helped me before?
Beautiful. Thank you so much. But I'll just make an announcement at the end, but before, we do have a few minutes for any last thoughts from each of you. Bruce?
Well, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity. I thank all the people who are doing work in the healthcare field. It's a really challenging time, but I you're really helping a lot of people. And you know, you make a difference, and this will pass. And there's a wonderful thing about living through challenging times is that it's really the only way to become wise. Mm. Nobody got wise from having an easy life. So, I mean, obviously there's a cost to wisdom, but the truth is this will, these experiences have the potential to make many of us grow in our capacity to be wise.
And I would just say, you know, the importance of caregivers to really take care of yourself, that is as important as anything else that we are doing. We can only get through this together if we take care of what we need and take care of one another. And that is the way that we're gonna make it through this long haul. It is critically important. Be well and take care of yourself.
Is there anything both of you have seen a lot, help people through a lot, and you know, sometimes people think this is, you know, feels a bit that there's nothing in the world that's been like this before, and you know, it's a little bit like the end of the world. And I'm just wondering, since you've seen people through disasters before, how are there comparisons to make that are helpful? How does this compare? What can we use to help us get through this?
Well, I imagine Lisa and her team as well, we've done a lot of work with community-wide challenges. But the unique thing about this, as you point out, is this is a worldwide experience. Mm-hmm. And in some ways, maybe this is the wrong language, but I really think that even when there's a worldwide bad thing, that has the potential to have, you know, make us recognize how we're all connected. And I do think that as this passes, maybe there will be opportunities for us to at least have a common touch point experience that we can use to continue to build compassion and build positive aspects of our humanity. I think it brings us together.
Yeah. And I agree with everything that Bruce just said. And I think we can all pull from other experiences. Like, I mean, in Puerto Rico, after Hurricane Maria, there was sort of this prolonged, not in the same way, but sort of no electricity and you can't do anything and you don't know when you're going to be able to go to work ever. There's some parallels there that I'm hearing people say, okay, well, we can actually, in Puerto Rico, bring something to the forefront, to the global context about, you know, how we have been going through this and the long-term effects of some of this, right? So I agree with Bruce that there are particular experiences and now this global experience that I think is opening, it has the potential to opening up new opportunities.
I have to admit, I just get the chills hearing both of you say that. I really do feel like that bigger view of our interconnectedness, our heart opening to others across the world, it's a phenomenal experience, and we will never be the same after this. Mm-hmm. Okay, time for my announcement. Thank you so much, both of you. That was just a phenomenal hour.
Thank you.
Many people will see this over the next few months, hopefully sooner than that, and it will be tremendously helpful. And I'm glad, Robert, that you're still listening. In our Department of Psychiatry, as in partnership with Jack Saul's group of clinicians in New York City, Jack Saul helped lead the 9/11 effort, we're developing a mini library of resources such as tapping, such as breathing, some of these psychological strategies to get through the moment. So I want to just emphasize what Bruce said. There's a lot of hospitals that don't have resources, no one in person, maybe not even telehealth for mental health support during this time. So we want to have all of you help push out this library when it's ready in about a week. And it will be just short 3-minute audios to help providers. Next week at this time, I hope you can all join us. We have a very special opportunity to hear Roshi Joan Halifax. She is a humanitarian. She leads medical missions in the Himalayas. She is the abbot of Upaya Zen Institute in New Mexico. But most relevant is she trains healthcare providers in preventing burnout and teaches about compassion and moral distress. And that is where we're at. We mentioned grief and this putting providers in these untenable positions. They become part of a system that is really can lead to moral injury. And so we'll be talking about those issues and really the ability to maintain self-compassion and compassion in those moments. So I look forward to being with you all next week. And thank you everyone for joining. Please join Robert's study. We'll send you an email with his study information. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.